30 years ago, Final Fantasy VI told a story that, to this day, is one of the darkest the medium of video games has ever seen. Its signature moment comes roughly halfway through the story, when the villain successfully acquires godlike power and causes a global catastrophe that disfigures the world. That alone is enough to cement VI's bleak reputation, but the desolation doesn't stop there. We see war crimes, mass kidnapping, forced experimentation, and slavery. A prominent NPC is mercilessly killed on screen, and depending on what we do as players, one of our protagonists can die, and another may attempt to take her own life. In the World of Ruin, some of the wildlife will simply perish via attrition, implying widespread ecological collapse. Forget video games. This is one of the gravest narratives you'll come across in any medium. And unlike some games that cynically employ such story elements for cheap gravitas, Final Fantasy VI engages with them thoroughly, earnestly, and thoughtfully. What results is an emotionally gripping and evergreen tale that is rich in potential interpretations and readings. And on that note, I don't know if you've looked around at the state of the world lately, but Final Fantasy VI's dark subject matter and narrative of devastating global-scale change feel more and more relevant with each passing day. And this is why, here on its 30th anniversary, I want to examine how the game reflects our own reality and what we can take away from it. So then, is Final Fantasy VI's brutal narrative a grim prophecy come true, or does it have something else in mind? Let's take a closer look. Chapter 1, Dread Destructive Force. This is but one of two videos I'm putting together about Final Fantasy VI. This video focuses primarily on the narrative, while the other analyzes the design and creative decisions, as well as some other technical details. So if that sounds interesting, be sure to subscribe to the channel and hit the bell, as that is due out next week. Now I'm going to ruin Final Fantasy VI by having the gall to say that a game about resisting empire and the end of the world is somehow political. Let's start out with a simple observation, which is so obvious and straightforward that it should be completely uncontroversial. We'll see about that. Final Fantasy VI is about magic. Magic is the force that enables the Empire's expansive conquest. The plot is set in motion when Terra, an Imperial slave born with the ability to use magic, falls into the custody of the Resistance. The game's most infamous moment, the destruction of the World of Balance, is the result of Kefka manipulating the global equilibrium of magic to his whim, and the game ends with magic fading from the world forever. Keeping things simple here, magic is power. A very specific form of power at that. FS6's magic embodies the concept of power over, which is contrasted against power to. Power over involves conquering, subjugating, and controlling other people, whereas power to describes the ability to, say, create something new or to solve a problem. Through what we're told and shown in the game, magic is overwhelmingly power over. To see what I mean here, let's venture through the entire story of magic in Final Fantasy VI. The Warring Triad are, well, exactly what that label suggests. Three gods who waged an apocalyptic war against each other. They are also the source of all magic in this world. During their conflict, they created slave soldiers by infusing magic into animals, including humans. These are the Espers. So from the jump, magic is shown to be a force for waging war and enslaving others. Those with more magic command those with less. Keep this in mind. Eventually, at some point, the Warring Triad looked upon the immense destruction they were causing and wisely decided to end their hostilities. They sealed themselves away, turning to stone, and created a magical equilibrium from which the world could recover from their devastating conflict. While doing this, they also released the Espers from their servitude, and for a time, the world finally knew peace. But the allure of magic, of having power over others, would fuel further strife. Humans hunted down or battled Espers seeking to take magic for themselves. This lustful and violent pursuit of power would culminate in the War of the Magi, another struggle that would all but annihilate the world. In its aftermath, the Espers decided to flee by creating a safe and sequestered realm for themselves, far from the presence or influence of humans. The Magi, those who once poached the Espers to claim their power, were now the only possessors of magic amongst their fellow humans. And this imbalance would yet again embroil the world in violent conflict. The Magi, once hunters of magical power, were now hunted for theirs. And like the Espers before them, they escaped to isolation and secrecy. Magic would fade from memory for the rest of civilization, becoming a distant legend. It wasn't gone, but it was instead hidden, buried, obfuscated. The world would recover once again. And thanks to rediscovering various technologies, human society seemingly flourished. This was, of course, until Emperor Gestahl and his troops discovered the Espers realm. As Imperial troops poured in, Gestahl promised riches to any of them who apprehended an Esper. Chaos ensued, and a few Espers were captured. But the rest of their kin mustered their magical power and forcibly expelled the invaders. Amidst this bedlam, a human woman carrying a baby flees the Esper realm before it is sealed off. This child is Terra, the offspring of this human woman and an Esper. As the gates slam shut, Emperor Gestahl happens upon the infant Terra, claiming her as the keystone of his ambitions. Following this raid, the Empire then established the Magitech Factory. Here, magic extracted from captive Espers combined with mechanized military hardware to create the formidable Magitech armor. With this newfound technological and magical supremacy, Gestahl and his forces conquer the neighboring city-states on the southern continent. Somewhere around 16 years later, the chance discovery of a frozen Esper in a coal mine sets the plot of Final Fantasy VI into motion. A now 18-year-old Terra, under the spell of a slave crown, takes point in an Imperial assault on the remote town of Narsh, where this Esper was found. The local defenses prove to be hapless against the might of Magitech armor, and the Imperials quickly reach their target. It's here that Terra comes face to face with the Esper, and the two begin to eerily resonate with one another. Her Imperial escorts, Biggs and Wedge, appear to be killed or banished through magical force, and Terra's Magitech armor explodes as she loses consciousness. Terra soon awakens in a house in Narsh, her slave crown removed, and her memories missing. She was found by a member of the Returners, a clandestine resistance against the Empire. Seeing an opportunity to turn the Empire's most powerful soldier against it, Returners are eager to recruit Terra to their cause. Our party, which is aligned with the Returners, is chiefly concerned with preventing Terra's re-enslavement by the Empire. They set out and arrive at the Returners' hideout. But just as they do this, the Empire's conquest of the northern continent begins, including a rapidly approaching incursion towards said hideout. Locke volunteers to infiltrate the recently captured town of South Figaro to act as spy and saboteur, while our other heroes flee on a river raft. But Sabin gets separated from the party, splitting our perspective into three briefly. Across this trio of adventures is where we witness the widespread scope and depravity of the Empire's campaign, and learned that they have retrained their sights on capturing the frozen Esper. Racing ahead of the invasion force, the party reconvenes at Narsh and begin fortifying for the battle to come. Together, they successfully hold the line and repel the Imperial invasion. Following the battle, Terra comes into contact with the Esper once more. Yet again, Terra awakens, but this time as a radiant monster. In a frenzy of confusion and fear, she flies off. The party eventually traces her whereabouts to Zozo, finding her resting under the careful watch of an Esper. This Esper, Rama, explains that he and some others escaped the Magitek research facility and hid here, and that their presence must have been what lured Terra to Zozo. He expounds further with two major revelations. First about Terra's mixed heritage, then about the Esper life cycle and the true way to gain an Esper's powers. The Empire's methodology of trying to extract magic from living Espers is flawed and ineffective compared to Magicite, the crystalline remains of a deceased Esper. Ramba presents the Magicite of his fellow Magitek factory victims who perished during their escape. Lastly, he surrenders his own life, entrusting his magic to our protagonists. He tasks the party with freeing those Espers still trapped in the Magitek research facility, stating that one of them may be able to help Terra reconcile her current existential crisis. An opera sequence later, the party has secure passage to the southern continent thanks to Setzer's airship, the Blackjack. The party soon infiltrates the Magitek factory, and then its core, the Magitek research facility. There, the surviving Espers pledge their power to our heroes, turning themselves into Magicite. But Kefka intervenes and sees how Magicite is made, learning that the secret to stealing the Espers' power is to kill them. Celis uses her magic to whisk Kefka and his troops away, along with herself, making an opening for the others to flee. The rest of the party make a daring escape by railcart, and then ward off a crane attack on the Blackjack. They manage to elude the Empire's clutches with their new Magicite in tow. They return to Zozo when one of the Magicite pieces begins to resonate with Terra. It's that of her father, Madwin, who reveals to Terra her true origin as half-human and half-Esper. Coming to, Terra snaps out of her frenzy, finding peace with her unique heritage. Meanwhile, the war is not going well. The Returners have no answer to the Empire's overwhelming material and materiel advantage. They conclude that their best course of action is to seek the aid of the remaining Espers on the other side of the sealed gate, with Terra as their emissary. They make their way there, ready for a conflict with the Imperial garrison stationed just outside. To their surprise, the Empire's camp is oddly abandoned. Nevertheless, our heroes press on, and Terra comes into contact with the sealed gate. But Kefka was lying in wait, hoping to take the opportunity to reinvade the Esper realm and capture even more magical power for the Empire. As the other party members fend off Kefka, there's finally a response to Terra's plea. The gate opens, and the Espers from the other side fly forth in a storm of righteous fury. The Blackjack, just stationed outside the sealed cave, is caught up in this magical tempest and is forced to crash land. The Espers seemed to have a singular objective on their mind, and were headed straight for the Imperial capital of Vector. Arriving there, we witnessed the seat of Empire in flames, devastated by the Espers' attack. Their mission of vengeance done, the Espers fly toward the remote Crescent Island. The Emperor, having endured a seemingly lethal blow to his military supremacy, sues for peace. At the following diplomatic banquet, the Returners and the Empire hash out the terms of an armistice. Concessions are made, such as the Empire agreeing to imprison Kefka for his war crimes. With the destructive potential of the Espers still on the loose, both sides agree to a joint mission to secure peace with them. Terra, again the bridge between humans and Espers, is chosen as envoy. But with the trail of the Espers turning cold, the expedition heads to the remote village of Themassa for leads. There, they find the local population to be acting somewhat odd. There certainly seems to be something going on in Themassa, as its residents are suspiciously reserved, guarded, not forthcoming. We meet the elder Strago and his artist granddaughter Realm before the party decides to turn in for the night. But they awaken to the town in a panic. A large house has caught fire, and Realm is trapped inside. In this moment of desperation, the people of Themassa reveal their secret and start casting magic in order to extinguish the flames. But their efforts prove ineffective, with the conflagration only growing more intense, perhaps due to the magical paraphernalia stored inside. Strago valiantly volunteers to enter the building and personally rescue his beloved granddaughter from the inferno. Our heroes, being heroic, agree to accompany him. And after dealing with the rogue magic at the heart of the flames, they themselves are rescued along with Realm by the mysterious mercenary Shadow. In the aftermath of this harrowing escape, Strago explains that the Thmasans can use magic because they are descendants of the Magi, humans who once hunted and claimed the Esper's powers as their own. They chose the location of Thmasa because it was out of the way, and put on the appearance of a quaint and unassuming village in order to evade further persecution. Strago also mentions that it's likely that the Espers sought out the mountains on the west side of Crescent Island, a place with latent magical properties. He agrees to guide the party there, reciprocating their help for rescuing Realm. A battle with a fourth wall breaking octopus later, Terra finds the Espers. We hard cut back to Thmasa, where General Leo and the Espers establish peaceful relations. This tranquility is quickly shattered when Kefka and a detachment of Magitek armor assault Thmasa. Kefka, now lusting after Magicite, begins massacring the Espers. He then toys with the endlessly and quite unforgivably naive Leo before shanking him as well. With a motherload of Magicite in tow, the Imperial forces move on to renew their conquest of the world. This alone is a devastating defeat for the Returners, but it gets worse. Not only are his forces stockpiled with more magic power than ever, but Gestahl has discovered the location of the warring triad. The floating continent emerges, and never has the Returner's mission been more urgent. With the source of all magic at his fingertips, Gestahl is moments away from absolute victory. The party fights their way through the Imperial Air Force and the various monstrosities of the floating continent, but they're too late. Gestahl, with Kefka and Celis at his side, stands before the three imposing statues of the petrified gods. We're presented with a brief hope spot, as Celis turns out to have been a double, triple, reverse agent. Either way, instead of hurting the party, she takes the opportunity to stab Kefka. But again, it proves too little, too late. Gestahl, however, isn't the one who seizes the ultimate power of magic. Rather, it's far worse, as Kefka beats him to the punch. A rabid dog, now off his leash, Kefka unrepentantly murders the Emperor, pushing the warring triad out of alignment in the process. With this delicate balance of magic now disrupted, the world erupts in planet-wide catastrophe. And just as Kefka turns his murderous intent towards our heroes, a timely intervention from Shadow buys them just enough time to escape. The party scrambles back to the airship as the floating continent, and the entire world for that matter, is falling apart around them. But just as they make it aboard and underway, the Blackjack is ripped into two, and our protagonists are scattered to the winds. On that day, the world was changed forever. Fade to black. Celis awakens after being nursed back to health by her surrogate grandfather, Cid. Cid explains that 1 year has passed since the cataclysm, and that the two of them are all that remains of the people of this solitary island. After spending so much time and energy caring for a comatose Celis, Cid falls ill himself. Following a gameplay sequence which determines Cid's fate, a raft he built provides Celis passage to the mainland. It's here that we see how the new balance of magical power has reshaped the world. Kefka sits atop a twisted spire of wreckage, fittingly at the same geographical location of the late Imperial capital, Vector. From there, he acts as the god of the world of ruin, raining down destructive rays of judgment onto those who fail to show him sufficient tribute. Most notable of his targets is Moblis, killing all of its adult population after a sustained barrage, turning it into a village of orphaned children. Those who are fortunate enough to survive the apocalypse and Kefka's reign find themselves in a world full of new horrors, or rather, old horrors that had once faded into myth and legend, which have now been unearthed and revived. Ancient dragons and demons walk the earth and terrorize its skies again. As I mentioned in the companion piece to this video, where I outline Final Fantasy VI's game design and structure, the World of Ruin is set up as an open world. As such, I won't be getting into some of the optional content, or at least not in this summary. Let's proceed along the critical path to the resolution of this story. After acquiring a new airship and presumably re-recruiting the scattered protagonists, our party makes their assault on Kefka's tower. A set of three paths, intertwined with one another, weave their way to the new god of magic himself. Along the way, our heroes must face the three gods of the warring triad and defeat them. Finally, they confront Kefka in perhaps the most grandiose final boss fight ever seen in gaming. Defeated, Kefka disintegrates. But along with him, the party's magicite dissolves as well. All magic in the world is fading, creating a potentially grave implication for Terra, a half-magical entity herself. Using the last of her power to safely usher the party out of the crumbling tower, Terra soon falls from the sky. The party, with Setzer at the helm of the airship, rescues Terra with some quick thinking and piloting. As the last bit of magic disappears from the world forever, Terra remains. She stands up, walks to the bow of the Falcon, and looks out on a world that is changing yet again. No longer a world of ruin, but not the old world of balance either. The music swells and the airship soars high in triumph. The end. There's a lot to take in here, but I want to keep our focus on the role of magic in this story. Let's come back to the concept of power over, because what this game shows us, from its world-building lore to the events of its plot, is that its conception of magic is solely a weapon for conquest and subjugation. There are some instances where we see magic being used for other purposes, but they are rare and off-label in their use. We see the Thomasa residents trying to put out a fire with their magic, the Espers expelling Gestahl and the Imperial forces from their realm, and Celis teleporting away with Kefka and his troops in order for the party to escape the Magitek factory. All three of these spells still have rather strong military applications, even if they're being used in a manner to defend oneself or prevent further destruction. The only clear, unambiguously restorative use of magic in the narrative is when Locke invokes Phoenix to revive Rachel, albeit briefly. Mechanically speaking, we of course have cure spells, which would have major implications on healing the sick and wounded in the world. But outside of this optional vignette in Thomasa, we never see healing magic used that way in the story, which is a glaring omission overall. Therefore, I think it's safe to infer that their purpose is, yet again, purely to facilitate waging war. But even simpler than that, remember that the source of all magic is the warring triad, and that their greatest legacy was using magic to turn animals into their slave soldiers, the Espers. From the very beginning of its world, Final Fantasy VI presents magic as a means of coercion and dominion, as power over, and nothing throughout the remainder of the story contradicts this in any meaningful way. Let's examine the three gods of the warring triad a little closer here. They're now known as Demon, Fiend, and Goddess, or Doom, Poltergeist, and Goddess in the original Ted Woolsey English translation. These are their titles, but did you know that the Warring Triad also have names? In concept art by Tetsuya Nomura, yes, that Nomura, we learned that Goddess's name is Sophia, Demon is Zervan, and Fiend is Sephiroth. And since he was also a writer for Final Fantasy VII, you can see that Nomura was enamored with this one particular concept from Jewish Kabbalah. And while we're here, I know the dude gets a lot of grief for his convoluted stories and weird directorial decisions recently, but looking at these concepts, he had some serious art chops back in the day. These names are quite curious, especially if we're thinking about magic's association with empire. Zervan is a deity worshipped by a sect of Zoroastrianism, fittingly called Zervanism. Zervanism rose to prominence during the Sassanid Empire, otherwise known as the Second Persian Empire, which ruled from circa 224 to 651 of the Common Era. Sophia, you might recall, is the Greek word for wisdom. This may be a reference to a figure in Gnostic beliefs, or more likely the Greek goddess of wisdom and warfare, Athena. In that case, I believe we can make the association of goddess with the Hellenic League or Macedonian Empire and the rule of Alexander the Great. Sephiroth comes from Jewish mysticism and pertains to the various manifestations of the Abrahamic god Jehovah. This could tie Fiend to the ancient kingdom of Israel, or a bit more of a stretch would be the much later Christian empires of Europe, such as Spain, France, and Great Britain. I believe this connection of the Warring Triad to real-world empires is deliberate, or at the very least unconsciously brilliant, as their magic is seized by the in-universe Gestalian Empire. Magic is political power, especially political power won by military force. This leads me to point out a peculiar aspect of magic in Final Fantasy VI. It's hereditary. This is shown right away with Terra's description. A mysterious young woman, born with the gift of magic. Terra also gained spells naturally, i.e. without having magicite equipped. We also have the residents of Themasa who don't appear to have any magicite on hand. As the War of the Magi ended ages ago, this would suggest that the Themasans owe their magical abilities to their lineage, just as Terra seems to have magic thanks to her Esper father. For everyone else, acquiring magic only seems possible through violence, either the death of an Esper, magicite, or through forcible extraction, the Magitek process. It therefore is no coincidence that through its backstory and what is shown on screen, Final Fantasy VI portrays magic as the catalyst for several apocalyptic struggles. So let's put this all together. Magic is closely associated with political power and dominance, and it is passed down through families. This power can only be transferred to others as a dying gift, as the Espers volunteer their power to our protagonists, or through violent conquest, as seen in the War of the Magi and Gestalt's imperial ambitions. So what is Final Fantasy VI getting at here? Do these characteristics not describe the social and political hierarchies of our world? Whether we speak of royal families or the children of industrial capitalists inheriting a controlling share of stocks in the family fortune, do we not see similar patterns of influence? Or how these power imbalances fuel constant war, most commonly when one powerful lord or oligarch tries to conquer another's share of power? Or when the masses do revolt, oftentimes a few opportunists swoop in to reorder the social stratification in their favor instead of abolishing it? Keep this in mind, especially as we move on to discuss the potential meaning of the world of balance. Chapter 2. Devil's Lab. As the opening scroll pans over the coal mining city of Narsh, we're told 1,000 years have passed since the War of the Magi. Iron, gunpowder, and steam engines have been rediscovered, and high technology reigns. Before our first input, the game establishes its steampunk setting, making Final Fantasy VI a prominent early example of this subgenre in the medium of video games. Now, it's quite possible that the team at Squaresoft chose steampunk purely for a unique aesthetic, or to simply justify Edgar's machinist mechanics, but I don't think this is the case. What leads me to that conclusion is how the world of balance contrasts with the world of ruin. As we brought up in the plot summary, the destruction of the world of balance unleashed demons and dragons across the globe. This gives the world of ruin a distinct feel. In other words, it's not just the post-apocalyptic ruins of the world of balance. These monsters are from the distant past, and along with settings like the ancient castle beneath Figaro, paint the world of ruin as something primeval. Placing these worlds side by side presents us with a treasure trove of possible thematic interpretations. Let's come back to the world of balance first. While this is a fantasy setting, steampunk evokes a particular era of our real world. Specifically, it harkens to the 19th century and perhaps early 20th century. Steam-powered locomotives fueled by coal, zeppelins in the skies, and the proliferation and development of firearms. Now, Final Fantasy VI plays fast and loose with steampunk conventions here. We see lasers, helicopters, and this sure looks like an internal combustion engine driving Figaro Castle. The key takeaway is, however, it shows a rapidly modernizing world not all that different from ours at the dawn of the 1900s. It is a world where science has supposedly replaced magic. Again, as the opening scroll says, high technology reigns. So you might be thinking that Final Fantasy VI presents a cautionary tale about the fragility of our so-called enlightened modern society. In particular, it's exceptionally easy to describe the world of ruin as literally a demon-haunted world, a term used by Carl Sagan to denote the darkness of superstition and paranoia that results in the absence of the light of science. Advancing this thinking further, one might notice a general secularity about the world of balance. The gods of the warring triad are frozen in stone, buried and long forgotten by most. There don't appear to be any churches or shrines or any significant mentions of religion, aside from a high priestess, which NPC mentions to highlight Edgar's pervasive sex pest behavior, and yeah, Edgar kinda sucks, folks. But he was written by a woman, graphic designer Kaori Tanaka, so maybe she was making a bit of a statement with him? Contrast this seemingly secular world with what followed after the events of the Floating Continent. We have, of course, Kefka wielding divine power atop this rather neat allusion to Dante Dante's Inferno and the assorted circles of hell. There's also a cult that worships him, and the fact that the warring triad have been revived. So then, is the World of Ruin a violent regression to a brutal pre-Enlightenment society? Have the reactionary forces of religiosity plunged the world into darkness by dismantling science and reason? And that only by overthrowing this superstition and irrationality can we set humanity back on the path of progress? I think this is a reading of Final Fantasy VI that one could understandably come to. And truth be told, it's one that I shared for a long time, but after reflecting on how the game presents magic as social hierarchy, I've come to a different conclusion. Let me explain. Consider the ending for a minute. The party hasn't just restored the world to the way it was right before the Empire and Kefka took power. They have, in fact, created a new world that has never existed before. A world without magic. And this, all the way at the end, is the first moment in this lengthy narrative that is presented as genuinely hopeful and optimistic. When you take this into account, the game's themes become far more deep, rich, and poignant. Final Fantasy VI diagnoses the true root of evil as the imbalance of power, where a select few rule over the many. As long as this hierarchy exists, there will be violent coercion, oppression, exploitation, and bloodshed. And in Final Fantasy VI, this imbalance of power is represented by the dread destructive force of magic. This is made abundantly clear in the World of Ruin, a vicious landscape where only the strong survive, brought about by the proliferation of magic. But this is also true about the World of Balance. While there may be good people who have this power over and who try to limit the harmfulness of it, as the Espers and the descendants of the Magi were attempting to do by secreting themselves away, ultimately, the ambitious, the greedy, and the ruthless will hunt said power down for their own interests. Despite appearances, magic wasn't gone, but it was instead hidden, or cleverly obfuscated, or transformed into a new mechanized tyranny. Think about it. How exactly is the World of Balance different from the might makes right brutality of the World of Ruin? For all the darkness and demons and rays of judgment of the latter, the former has the following. Imperialism, occupation, and the forced conscription of conquered peoples. Terra's slave crown, and Celis being forced into the Magitek Knight program at an early age. War crimes, the torching of Miranda, the poisoning of Doma, the act of perfidy that was the Empire's bad faith armistice before the Thamasa mission, the kidnapping, enslavement, forced experimentation upon, and genocide of the Espers. What is shown right here is the reason why I don't subscribe to the prior reading of Final Fantasy VI that I mentioned before. That is, the one which depicts the World of Balance as some golden age of reason that gets torn down by anti-intellectualism and ancient superstition. Kefka did not acquire godlike power by whipping up religious fervor and becoming the object of worship the world over. Instead, he acquired power that already existed, and only after doing so was he worshipped as an almighty god. Despite all the advancements of science and technology in the World of Balance, the potential for widespread cruelty was still there all along. The intellectual developments of modernity have not replaced the underlying power structures of the past. Instead, they act as not much more than a shallow veneer, papering over said structures. Thus, the World of Ruin is not some regression of genuine progress, because the World of Balance doesn't represent genuine progress. The World of Balance is the myth of progress. The World of Ruin is simply what remains when this thin mask burns away. And where this really hits home is when we remember how the World of Balance's steampunk aesthetics draw our attention to real-world modern history. We're frequently told, especially by those who currently wield power and privilege, that we are living in a far more advanced or evolved age. Thanks to the Enlightenment values formulated in 17th and 18th century Europe, they argue, we have moved beyond the mysticism and barbarism of the past into a truly civilized era. This supposed social evolution claims that we are no longer ruled by brutality, but instead by reason. Proponents of this argument frequently point to the rapid rise in living standards brought about by the technological innovations of the last couple centuries. They go on to link these advancements with the Enlightenment political system of Western liberalism and its dominance over the world in that time span. Now, no doubt some of these discoveries were a product of increased scientific rigor and theoretical speculation that accompanied Enlightenment thinking, but many breakthroughs came about the way they always have throughout history. By happenstance. I should also note that the increase in living standards from this new technology was mostly seen only in the wealthy industrialized nations of Europe and the Anglosphere. And for all the advancements in food production, medicine, communication, and transportation, new technology also paved the way for new horrors. One not need look anywhere else but the obvious. The Second World War. Nazi Germany employed industrial methodology, including chemical agents, to massacre millions of Jews, Romani, queer people, disabled people, socialists and communists, and anyone else the Nazi Party deemed undesirable. The United States developed the atomic bomb and dropped it not once but twice on civilian population centers, well after Japan had lost the capability to effectively wage war. As Theodore Adorno and Max Horkheimer elaborate in The Dialectic of Enlightenment, these horrific inventions were not a glitch or perversion of Enlightenment ideology, but rather a compliant consequence.
Enlightenment, understood in the widest sense as the advance of thought, has always aimed at liberating human beings from fear and installing them as masters. Yet the wholly enlightened earth is radiant with triumph and calamity. Enlightenment's program was the disenchantment of the world, and wanted to dispel myths to overthrow fantasy with knowledge. Bacon, the father of experimental philosophy, brought these motifs together. He despised the exponents of tradition, who substituted belief for knowledge and were as unwilling to doubt as they were the reckless in supplying answers. All this, he said, stood in the way of the happy match between mind of man and the nature of things, with the result that humanity was unable to use its knowledge for the betterment of its condition. Such inventions as had been made, Bacon cites printing, artillery, and the compass, had been arrived at more by chance than by systematic inquiry into nature. Knowledge obtained through such inquiry would not only be exempt from the influence of wealth and power, but would establish man as the master of nature. Technology is the essence of this knowledge. It aims to produce neither concepts nor images nor the joy of understanding, but method, exploitation of the labor of others. Capital. The many things which, according to Bacon, knowledge still held in store are themselves mere instruments. The radio as sublimated printing press, the dive bomber as a more effective form of artillery, remote control as a more reliable compass. What human beings seek to learn from nature is how to use it to dominate wholly both it and human beings. Nothing else counts. Ruthless toward itself, the Enlightenment has eradicated the last remnants of its own self-awareness.
But it's not just that an honest application of Enlightenment reasoning can lead us to create devices of mass death and destruction, or even that said reasoning, when taken to its logical extremes, becomes this inhuman engine of hell as Adorno and Horkheimer illustrate. A plain fact is that most of Enlightenment's champions have shown that they are unable or unwilling to apply rationality, skepticism, and empiricism consistently to all things, least of all their own cherished beliefs and prejudices. Or, more to the point, they use such rationality and empiricism to cobble together post hoc rationales for their already existing worldview. Nowhere is this more apparent than in the attempts by Enlightenment thinkers to explain and to justify the existence of social hierarchies as foundational to civilization. In their book, The Dawn of Everything, archaeologist David Wengrow and anthropologist David Graeber critically examined two of these hypotheses, both of which have had enormous impacts on contemporary political thought. The first is at the root of much of today's conservative political theory. In Leviathan, Thomas Hobbes posits that the state of nature for humanity is a war of all against all. In other words, Hobbes sees humans as fundamentally selfish creatures who, without any structure imposed upon them, will invariably devolve into dog-eat-dog chaos. Therefore, Hobbes follows, hierarchy and domination aren't simply justified for creating a civil society. Rather, hierarchy and domination are civil society. The more liberal hypothesis comes from an essay by Jean-Jacques Rousseau. In Discourse on the Origin and Foundation of Inequality Among Mankind, Rousseau makes the opposite assertion that Hobbes does. Humanity, in its base state, is actually quite peaceful and egalitarian. The problem comes, Russo argues, when humans leave their small bands of hunter-gatherers to form cities and to practice agriculture. Russo believes that the fruits of civilization come at a cost, one which requires forceful coercion and social stratification. Thus, humans made a Faustian bargain, trading away their natural freedom and equality for urban life and massive food production. In his mind, Russo believes that there is no other way to achieve such things. So which one of these two hypotheses is the correct one? The truth is, neither of them. Both authors clearly started with the assumption that society as they knew it was some inevitable conclusion of human history, and then went backward in time trying to cobble together a rationale for why it had to be that way. For instance, how did these two men figure out what prehistoric humans were like? Well, as Wengrow and Graeber point out, they made it all up. They didn't have access to even a fraction of the archaeological record that we do now, but it probably wouldn't have mattered if they did. Each man fabricated from whole cloth, whichever state of nature suited his argument. The key point I want to emphasize here is that Enlightenment thought, instead of criticizing or holding the culture it came from to account, instead was frequently used to excuse said culture's worst behaviors. Both Hobbes's and Rousseau's hypotheses were used to gussy up cruel practices and institutions in the cloak of rationality, in particular, the colonial conquest of the world by European nations.
Rousseau has been accused of many crimes. He is innocent of most of them. If there is really a toxic element in his legacy, it is this, not his promulgation of the image of the noble savage, which he didn't really do, but his promulgation of what we might call the myth of the stupid savage, even if one he considered blissful in its state of stupidity. 19th century imperialists adopted this stereotype enthusiastically, merely adding on a variety of ostensibly scientific justifications, from Darwinian evolution to scientific racism, to elaborate on the notion of innocent simplicity and thus provide a pretext for pushing the remaining free people of the world, or increasingly, as European imperial expansion continued, the formerly free peoples, into a conceptual space where their judgments no longer seemed threatening.
And it wasn't just Hobbes or Rousseau. For a more explicit example of how a supposedly logical and well-reasoned notion can be used to enable heinous acts, let's focus on the political theories of John Locke. Interesting. Anyhow, John Locke's writings were a noted influence on many of America's founding fathers. In particular, I want to highlight Locke's theory of property, which is built upon the principle of improvement.
The principle of improvement as the basis of property rights was working its way into the law, into legal disputes about property, especially over enclosure. It also appeared in political theory, notably in the work of John Locke. When we unpack his famous idea that individuals acquire a right to property by mixing their labor with it, we find at its heart the notion of improvement, the idea of productivity for profit, the idea that the natural right of property derives from its productive use. People acquire a right to property by giving it value, which Locke makes very clear means exchange value. This had vast implications not only for the domestic practice of enclosure, but also for the dispossession of indigenous peoples in colonial territories. And on that score, Locke was quite explicit.
It's important to note here that the etymology of the word improvement comes from a French word meaning to make profitable. And for generations, the native peoples of North America employed methods of sustainable cultivation to reliably meet their needs. Since most tribes and nations ensured that none of their members went without the necessities of life, they had no reason to generate a surplus for sale. This led the European settlers to conclude that the lands on their frontier were going to waste because they were not being adequately improved. What followed was wide-scale land theft and the genocide of the indigenous populations. It is very comforting to think that we live in a world that has advanced beyond barbarism, that our society's morality is as refined as our technology. But this is not the case. For those of us who live in the bloc of imperial countries, the majority of this brutality is kept out of sight, thousands of miles away, in cobalt mines, in sweatshops, on modern-day cocoa plantations. But even our own nations peddle to us citizens a counterfeit freedom. Sure, we're free to go anywhere, to do whatever we want, and to form relations with whoever we please, provided we have the money to do so. If not, well, we're expected to work for someone who does. And following that usually grueling labor, we have less of our time and probably still not enough money to do as we please. Instead of feudal lords, we have corporate bosses. Instead of being forced to work the fields at sword point by a noble's knights, we get evicted from our homes by police officers when we can't make rent. The social hierarchy and the resulting power imbalance haven't gone away. They've merely transformed into something harder to recognize, hidden through layers of indirection. This might seem like an overstatement, and those of you hearing such assertions for the first time are probably skeptical. I want to tell you that's perfectly fine, good even. Please be skeptical. I have provided a list of sources in the description of this video if you'd like to learn more. The simple truth is that a few people have all of the power in the world, which they pass on to their heirs, while the rest of us toil for their benefit. My fellow Americans may be saying something like, "But we can vote, right?" Well, the research shows that our elected officials reliably serve the interests of corporations and the wealthy, not us. I invite you to take a gander at the 2014 study by Martin Gillens and Benjamin Page, which backs up this claim, but I'll leave you with this money quote. These results suggest that reality is best captured by mixed theories in which both individual economic elites and organized interest groups, including corporations largely owned and controlled by wealthy elites, play a substantial part in affecting public policy, but the general public has little or no independent influence. Don't let the jet planes and smartphones fool you. The world is as brutal and unjust as ever, if not more so. That is the lesson of Final Fantasy VI's World of Balance. Unfortunately, the lesson of the World of Ruin is that things are going to get worse before they get better. Chapter 3. Dark World. The pursuit of power inevitably leads to calamity. This is the central theme of Final Fantasy VI, which it emphasizes throughout its lore and plot. Both the initial power struggle of the Warring Triad and the War of the Magi are said to have brought the world to the brink of annihilation. And then we see Kefka's insatiable hunger for power bring about the World of Ruin. More on him in a few. So, how does this relate to the real world? What sort of thematic undercurrents might accompany this mid-story apocalypse? Casting our minds back 30 years ago, there's one historical event that looms large in the early 90s. December 25th, 1991 saw the illegal dissolution of the Soviet Union, and with it, the end of the Cold War. This might have been fresh in the minds of the development team, as Final Fantasy VI entered production a year later, and the World of Ruin might have been a reflection on this seemingly quelled decades-long threat of nuclear Armageddon. This spell scene here, which does fire and wind damage to the entire field, the player's party included, has been more recently localized as Meltdown, and that certainly hints at these atomic age anxieties. That's just speculation, however. It's impossible to know exactly what the devs had in mind when they created the World of Ruin, but one wild fact that's come to light in interviews is that it didn't exist in the original working concept of the game. They had built out everything up to the confrontation with Gestahl and Kefka on the floating continent, which was intended to be the finale, but in a rare feat of game development, they were somewhat ahead of their production schedule. So they asked, what if the game didn't end here? The rest is history. Since the World of Ruin was a mid-production, spur-of-the-moment decision, it's unlikely that the dev team had elaborate intentions with regards to its themes and metaphors. But the curious thing about art is that it is subject to interpretation, and the meaning of a story can take on a life of its own, beyond whatever its authors directly intended. And this is why, in my opinion, Final Fantasy VI has endured in the minds of so many players. There's plenty of room for such interpretation, and onto which we can project our experiences. And given the state of the world here in early 2024, the story of Final Fantasy VI is as pertinent and relevant as ever. There's no use sugarcoating it. Our world is on course for disaster. There are, unfortunately, several fronts where this is true, but the most immediately obvious one is the climate catastrophe happening right now. Despite a noticeable dip due to the lockdown era of the still ongoing COVID-19 pandemic, fossil fuel production and consumption, as well as corresponding CO2 emissions, have returned to either record or near record levels. This is despite all manner of research showing that, in order to prevent destructive levels of warming, we need to drastically cut our usage of fossil fuels right now. This addiction to oil and coal can be tied to one thing: the pursuit of profit. Or put another way, the pursuit of economic power. Don't be misled by arguments pinning the blame for climate change on overpopulation. The correlation between population and emissions is quite weak, especially when compared to one of the strongest correlations to emissions, GDP, or gross domestic product, a measure of economic output. It is the wealthiest, most industrialized nations that are contributing disproportionately to the rise in global temperatures, not poor, underdeveloped countries in the global south. The results of this greed-fueled pollution are going to be very, very ugly. The Paris Climate Accords established a target of limiting global warming to 2 degrees Celsius, a threshold where permanent global-scale damage will be unavoidable and irreversible. It should be noted that many climate scientists have argued that this target is far too lax. That is, warming needs to be curtailed even more aggressively. The bad news is that along our current trajectory, we're going to fail meeting this target quite spectacularly and quite soon. Using this metric, we are already at plus 1.1 degrees Celsius per the latest IPCC report, with no significant indications that global fossil fuel use will reverse course anytime in the near future. What will the world look like if we let warming continue unabated? Well, it will look a lot like the world of ruin. Global warming of 4 degrees Celsius and above is projected to lead to far-reaching impacts on natural and human systems. High confidence. Beyond 4 degrees Celsius of warming, projected impacts on natural systems include local extinction of approximately 50% of tropical marine species, medium confidence, and biome shifts across 35% of global land area, medium confidence. At this level of warming, approximately 10% of the global land area is projected to face both increasing high and decreasing low extreme stream flow, affecting, without additional adaptation, over 2.1 billion people, medium confidence, and about 4 billion people are projected to experience water scarcity, medium confidence. At 4 degrees Celsius of warming, the global burned area is projected to increase by 50 to 70% and the fire frequency by approximately 30% compared to today, medium confidence. These are just the direct circumstances that intense warming is likely to bring. It shouldn't take too much imagination to see that with billions of people being displaced by shifting coastlines and spreading deserts, and with resources becoming scarce or less reliable due to drought and severe weather, the potential for violent conflict will also escalate rather quickly. And, as I said, the climate is just one aspect of our world that appears to be headed off of a cliff. At the moment, we also have the ongoing conflict in Ukraine and rising tensions concerning Taiwan, both situations that make a shooting war between nuclear powers a grim possibility again. We're also seeing genocidal programs being enacted right now, and, not entirely unrelated, a surge of fascist movements around the globe. Coming back to Final Fantasy VI, let's take a closer look at its resident fascist regime and how it produced the architect of the World of Ruin, Kefka Palazzo. Chapter 4. Dancing Mad. At first glance, calling the Gestalian Empire fascist may seem a bit of a stretch. Sure, there's the brown-shirted stormtroopers, this rather conspicuous rally scene with lots of saluting, and the Magitek Knight process resembling an uber-soldat or super-soldier program. But all of that seems rather shallow or tenuous evidence at best. Furthermore, the Gestalian Empire lacks a common ingredient for fascism that we've discussed on this channel before, the desire to restore a mythic past. For instance, Italy under Mussolini invoked the glory of old Rome. The Nazis made a similar connection by citing Germany's history as the seat of the Holy Roman Empire. What you see here is called the Roman Salute, although its historical connections to the ancient Roman Empire are dubious at best. Fascists make a lot of shit up. It's important to recognize the myths of their mythic pasts. In contrast, it appears that Gestalt's empire is an upstart newcomer on the world stage. Vector conquering its neighboring city-states on the southern continent is a very recent development with no greater historical context. So does this mean that it isn't fascist, then? Well, it's important to remember that there was another early 20th century regime besides fascist Italy and Nazi Germany, one that had an emperor, one that underwent rapid industrialization and militarization, quickly using these new advantages to conquer its neighbors shortly thereafter. It's also one much closer to home for the creators of Final Fantasy VI. I speak, of course, about Imperial Japan. The Meiji Restoration of 1868 saw the emperor reinstated as the head of the Japanese state following centuries of rule by the Tokugawa shogunate. Now, the emperor's role was largely symbolic, with his ministers making and enacting a majority of the policy decisions. But either way, this new government was responsible for a period of quick and widespread modernization, transforming Japan from a secluded and agrarian society into an industrial world power. Imperial Japan would not wait long to test out its newfound military might, shocking the world with victories over China in 1894 and then against Russia in 1905. This would clear the path for Japan to formally annex Korea in 1910. To fast forward a bit, fascism enters the equation for Imperial Japan following World War I. After a severe economic downturn, a right-wing militarist movement seized control of the government, which in turn renewed Japan's expansionism and conquest of Asia. And make no mistake, Japanese fascism was just as horrendous as its European counterparts. I want to make that clear because I'm going to focus on one particular practice here, and I don't want you to get the impression that I'm minimizing other atrocities by omission. In fact, if you would like to know more, I'd recommend a Lost Futures video on the topic as a good starting point. Just be warned that this is not exactly warm and fuzzy subject matter. Returning to Final Fantasy VI, does rapid industrialization, conquest of neighboring states, and the presence of an emperor make the Gestalian Empire a stand-in for Imperial Japan? This post on Reddit certainly makes that argument, and yeah, I can see the resemblance. But I want to share a more specific example that really solidifies this association. I want to draw your attention to a curious and maybe easy-to-miss detail. This old woman in Miranda mentions that following the town's fall, the Empire forcibly conscripted Miranda's citizens. This fact gets reinforced in several places. One of these Mirandans is the injured Imperial deserter in Mobliz, where we have an optional quest to read and reply to mail from his lover, Lola. This scene shows us General Leo addressing a trooper from Miranda. Lastly, after the peace banquet, the Imperial troops withdraw from Miranda and one of these forced conscripts returns, saying that the Imperial army made him do, quote, some awful things. As you can see, this isn't a throwaway line by a single random NPC, it's a very deliberate and repeated part of the text. And this practice of forced conscription isn't an invention of fiction either. Between 1939 and 1945, Imperial Japan brought in some 800,000 Korean citizens. Most were assigned precarious work in mines and factories, but over 200,000 of them fought for the Japanese military. Some may have signed up voluntarily, but many did not.
The outbreak of World War I in 1914 called on Africans to make the ultimate sacrifice for their mother country, even if they had never set foot on its soil.
I believe this thoroughly crystallizes the association between the Gestalian Empire and Imperial Japan. So why is this important? Because this fascist society gives us the context to understand the main antagonist of this story. A large number of Final Fantasy fans designate Kefka as the greatest villain of the series, and some go even further to say that he's one of the best in all of video games. For the most part, I agree with this, but where I differ comes in identifying what exactly makes Kefka such a great bad guy. There's two arguments that I've frequently heard over the decades that go like this.
Kefka is a great villain because he actually achieved his objectives.
Or,
Kefka is a great villain because he's the video game equivalent of the Joker.
Now, if you'll excuse me, neither one of these arguments is convincing from where I sit. Sorry. The first merely describes what happens in the plot. Sure, it's shocking, even to this day, to see the villain succeed in destroying the world. That's among the greatest end of Act 2 gut punches in anything, ever. But this says nothing about Kefka's characterization. I find the second argument to be wrong on several levels. I know games are a relatively young art form, but we really need to get over our impulse to praise ersatz copies of notable stuff from other media. Not that Kefka is an ersatz copy of the Joker, mind you. On that note, this comparison seems to stem from some very superficial similarities between the two. The clown makeup, the tendency to crack bad jokes while being cruel, and perhaps origin stories where an experimental or industrial accident causes psychosis. That last one is a real, if you squint hard enough, scenario, but also isn't applicable depending on which version of the Joker we're talking about. Now, I'm no comic book scholar, but I do know, thanks to a quick search, that the Joker has been around since Batman number 1, all the way back in 1940, and he's had many interpretations and incarnations since then. But I think I can safely make a blanket assertion that Kefka Palazzo differs from practically all instances of the Joker in one very important way. The Joker is a criminal, meaning that his power is usually not legally sanctioned. Yes, sometimes he's a crime lord or a leader of a syndicate, and he occasionally gains the upper hand over Gotham or wherever, so he can be an authority in this regard from time to time. But he's almost always operating either in direct opposition to, or outside of, institutional power. Kefka, on the other hand, is a government official with a lot of institutional backing. While it doesn't appear that he has a formal military rank, he frequently acts as a general in the Imperial forces, such as when he inherits command from General Leo during the Siege of Doma, or leads the assault on Narsh. And although Kefka puts on the air of being a loose cannon, or perhaps more descriptively, a rabid dog, and that his supposed insubordination provides cover for Imperial war crimes, he's pretty clearly Emperor Gestahl's right-hand man all along. Well, up until he pushes him off the floating continent, I guess. While she's being detained and tortured for desertion in South Figaro, Celis shares knowledge about Kefka's plan to poison Doma, implying it was at best an open secret in the Imperial army. Therefore, Gestahl knew precisely what he was doing when he recalled Leo and had Kefka take command there. And later, it's obvious that throwing Kefka in prison was a purely performative gesture on his part. That should be enough to dispel this ill-conceived comparison of Kefka to the Joker, but we can go even further. Because, personality-wise, Kefka is quite different from popular depictions of the Batman villain. I speak, of course, about two recent and widely known interpretations of the character, Heath Ledger in 2008's The Dark Knight, and Joaquin Phoenix in 2019's Joker. And hey, wasn't there a third one during this time? Joaquin Phoenix's Joker is straightforward. I think this clip sums up his whole deal pretty well.
Be a joke.
What do you get?
I don't think so.
When you cross a mentally ill loner with a society that abandons him and treats him like trash!
Call the police,
I'll
Gene.
Tell you what you get!
Call the police!
You get what you fucking deserve!
Now, I'm not the first to say this, but it's important enough to repeat. I believe this movie means well, but it perpetuates a harmful misconception. That is, the notion that mentally ill people, especially when deprived of medication and treatment, are likely to be hazardous towards others. This is not true, and research bears this out. Mentally ill people are far more likely to be victims of violence than perpetrators of it. Ledger's take on the Joker is harder to pin down on account that his whole shtick is that he lies all the time, but there are a couple of moments where I think his true intentions slip through this facade. The first is his conversation with a recently disfigured Harvey Dent, where the Joker is talking about those in positions of power as schemers. The second moment is a scaled-up prisoner's dilemma involving two ferries rigged with explosives, with each boat having the detonator for the other. This presents the Dark Knight's Joker as somewhat Hobbesian. If you recall from the section on the World of Balance and Enlightenment thought, Thomas Hobbes believed that the base state of humanity was utter mayhem and violent chaos, and that the only way to achieve social order was through force. Some may interpret this as a moral imperative to use violence and hierarchy to establish quote-unquote civil society. Ledger's Joker agrees with Hobbes' assessment about the state of nature for humans, but definitely disagrees with Hobbes' remedy for it. He instead concludes that this effort to impose social order is ultimately futile, and sets about to actively demonstrate this, to prove the schemers wrong. In short, this Joker is what people who haven't read any anarchist writings think anarchism is. My point about these two Jokers is that both of them are, in their own ways, highly critical of, if not outright hostile towards, authority and existing power structures. And this is where Kefka, a servant of a fascist regime, couldn't be any more different from them. Kefka is not the Joker, because Kefka is an authoritarian. We've already established Kefka has a fitting role for an authoritarian, being an imperial operative. But I want to focus more on his personality, specifically in how it very closely resembles that of real-world authoritarians. To do that, let's go through his appearances in Final Fantasy VI, scene by scene. Chronologically, our first glimpse of Kefka is a very quick one. He places the slave crown on Terra, then instructs her to burn up everything. Throughout this, he appears gleeful, laughing at the death and destruction as we fade to black. We later learn that Terra incinerated some 50 Imperial soldiers during this incident. This is a very economical scene, showing us quite a lot about Kefka in 48 seconds of screen time. We see him taking delight in enslaving and owning Terra, as well as his callous or perhaps sadistic disregard for the Imperial infantry serving under him. From this, we can comfortably extrapolate that Kefka's allegiance to the Empire is not born out of some love of country, or his fellow citizens, or some ideological conviction, but rather the power that it affords him. Our next scene sees Kefka acting as an ambassador to Figaro Castle, attempting to retrieve Terra back to the Empire. After forcing his subordinates to dust the sand off his boots and storming past the guard at the front gate, Kefka confronts Edgar about Terra's whereabouts. Edgar feigns ignorance, to which Kefka replies with, "I'd hate to be you if we find out you're lying," followed by a laugh. The next morning, Kefka has set the castle ablaze. The party flees and fights off the pursuing Magitek armors, and Kefka utters the classic Wolseyism, "Son of a submariner!" It's important to remember at this moment that Figaro and the Empire are nominally allies. When we parse Kefka's quip about Edgar lying, it certainly gives the impression that he's eager to find a reason to violently break this alliance. Next, we come to the Imperial base camp outside of Doma. General Leo is summoned back to Vector, but before he departs, he and Kefka have a brief conversation. Kefka boasts that he will conclude the siege of Doma in short order, which prompts Leo to remind him that the residents of Doma are people. Kefka retorts, "We need not spare those lands that give rise to the Returners." Immediately upon taking command of the camp, Kefka dumps poison into the river, killing all in Doma Castle, including, what we're told, Imperial POWs being held captive there. This is perhaps Kefka's most infamous scene, in part because this is where we learn exactly how dangerous he is. The prior scene showed him being cavalier with the lives of his own men, which is certainly unnerving in its own right, and his ineffectual assault on Figaro Castle, where it seemed he might be playing a more comedic role in the narrative. The poisoning of Doma puts that to bed quite conclusively. This is a war crime, plain and simple, one in which Kefka takes perverse pride and joy. We're shown his disdain for morality and honor, and his statement about those lands that give rise to the Returners demonstrates an enthusiastic endorsement of collective punishment. In a similar vein, Kefka is next seen leading the invasion of Narsh, where he orders his troops to exterminate everyone despite Narsh's neutral status. After we successfully ward off the incursion on Narsh, we don't see Kefka again until the Magitek factory. Here he does a quick villainous monologue mentioning his plans to find the warring triad. He then proceeds to dump what he believes are the useless husks of Ifrit and Shiva down a garbage chute. This scene really captures Kefka's attitude with regards to power, and how he treats people he perceives as beneath him. Kefka gets off on having power over others, and specifically he rather enjoys the prospect of putting people in their place. An instructive counterexample here is the Emperor himself. Gestalt is shown being rather cold towards those he harms. He's indifferent toward people outside of their utility to him. Kefka, on the other hand, has a seething disgust for those he perceives as below him in the social hierarchy, and takes great pride reminding them of his superiority. After the Magitek factory, when Terra and the party go to contact the Espers on the other side of the sealed gate, Kefka springs an ambush. After the Espers storm out of the sealed gate and rush Vector, Kefka is next seen in a jail during the peace talks. As we've gone over, this was a performance by Gestahl to garner goodwill from the Returners, and as part of a bigger scheme to lull them off guard, the payoff of which is Kefka spearheading another ambush, this time in Themassa, where he kills General Leo and a host of Espers, harvesting their Magicite. This further illustrates that Kefka regards honor, fighting fair, and morality as being for suckers. And again, he looks at anyone standing up to him as an opportunity to escalate his cruelty, something he relishes. Moving along, Kefka shows his true colors before the warring triad, betraying Gestahl without remorse and claiming the ultimate power of magic for himself. This moment demonstrates another important aspect of Kefka's personality, his opportunism. His allegiance to Gestahl was always conditional on the power and the license for cruelty that it granted him, and nothing else. When an opening to usurp the Emperor presented itself, Kefka took it without an ounce of hesitation or compunction. Lastly, we have Kefka as God of the World of Ruin. Early on in the World of Ruin, we directly see a ray of judgment hit Zen, and also witness the aftermath of Moblis. Kefka seems to tire of this practice, however, and by the time we confront him in his tower, he seems bored. But one thing that does snap him out of this ennui is our heroes sharing their motivations for keeping on, which he rebukes by saying they sound like chapters of a self-help booklet. This is when he threatens to create a monument to non-existence, which seems motivated chiefly by spite more than anything. Finally, after the party defeats him, he dissolves away into the blessed nothingness he admired so much. Kefka is an authoritarian. This is not just my opinion. Final Fantasy VI paints a striking portrait that resembles what clinical research into the psychology of authoritarians has found. I will start with the findings of Theodore Adorno and colleagues, who summarized their extensive psychological studies in their book, The Authoritarian Personality.
Admiration of power and a longing for strong leadership on the social scene as predominant in the high scorer may readily be interpreted as a carryover from the hierarchical evaluation of interpersonal relationships. Extreme personal opportunism is often, though not always, connected with ideological opportunism and indifference towards ideological content. Status anxiety, adherence to external criteria in value judgments, thinking in stereotypes, and the lack of a concept of equality is closely related to a contempt of what is allegedly socially inferior. Fear of one's own weakness and emasculation prevents the development of pity for the weak.
Opportunism, indifference towards ideological content, and a contempt of what is allegedly socially inferior. As we've outlined, these describe Kefka to a T. But wait! There's more.
The orientation towards conventional values in the high scorers as compared to orientation towards more intrinsic and basic values in the low scorers was found to extend over different areas of life. Related to conventionalism is the tendency toward admiration of and search for power. Likewise, more pronounced in the typical high scorer. The comparative lack of ability for affectionate and individualized interpersonal relations, together with the concept of a threatening and dangerous environment, must be seen as underlying the prejudiced individual's striving for the attainment of power, either directly or by having the powerful on his side. In this context, we often find a frame of mind best characterized as overrealism, a tendency to utilize everything and everyone as a means to an end. Needless to say, such overrealism seems but rarely to lead to a real attainment of the goals involved, and thus to ultimate satisfaction. It often involves strained interpersonal relations and possible or actual retaliation, of which there is much fear. The conflict arising from an unaccepted and unrecognized dependency on others for things and benefits, on the one hand, and the hostility stemming from distrust, envy, and feelings of being thwarted, on the other, cannot be resolved.
Again, the admiration and search for power and the over-realistic frame of mind outlined here describe Kefka exceptionally well, not only in his tendency to utilize everything and everybody as a means to an end, which he demonstrates quite clearly with Emperor Gestahl, but his self-help booklet quip shows his disdain for empathy and social connection. Building upon Adorno and Coe's work, Bob Altmaier conducted his own research into authoritarians that is quite pertinent here. Altmaier focused on identifying the psychological differences between authoritarian leaders and their followers. From his research, Altmaier grouped authoritarians into two usually exclusive psychological categories. The first is what he calls right-wing authoritarians, or RWAs. This is a bit confusing because it doesn't directly pertain to the subject's political beliefs, but rather their admiration of and compliance with established authorities and social conventions. It's quite possible for someone who espouses left-wing ideology to also exhibit RWA characteristics. Such characteristics are rigid adherence to social norms, unquestioning obedience to their authority figure, and hostility towards those deemed enemies by said authority figure. As such, RWAs tend to make up the bulk of authoritarian followers. So what about the other side of the equation? What sort of psychological profile is typical for an authoritarian leader? For that, we'll need to look into Altmaier's second category, social dominators.
Social dominance scores correlate very strongly with these answers to the power mad scale. High scorers are inclined to be intimidating, ruthless, and vengeful. They scorn such noble acts as helping others and being kind, charitable, and forgiving. Instead, they would rather be feared than loved and viewed as mean, pitiless, and vengeful. They love power, including the power to hurt in their drive to the top. Authoritarian followers do not feel this way because they seldom have such drive to start with.
Sound familiar? Kefka is a social dominator through and through. An RWA would never defy Gestalt, let alone violently betray him as Kefka did. And as we see here, the social dominator tag is tailored perfectly to him.
Social dominators thus admit, anonymously, to striving to manipulate others and to being dishonest, two-faced, treacherous, and amoral. It's as if someone took the scout law, a scout is trustworthy, loyal, helpful, friendly, and turned it completely upside down. A winner is deceitful, manipulative, unfair, base, and conniving. Furthermore, while the followers may feel admiration bordering on adoration of their leaders, we should not be surprised if the leaders feel a certain contempt for their followers. They are the suckers, the marks, the fools social dominators find so easy to manipulate. Why are social dominators hostile? Well, unlike high RWAs who fear an explosion of lawlessness, they already live in the jungle that authoritarian followers fear is coming. And they're going to do the eating. They do not ask themselves, when they meet someone, is there any reason why I should try to control this person? So much as they ask, is there any reason why I should not try to gain the upper hand with him right now? Dominance is the first order of business with them in a relationship, like dogs encountering each other in a schoolyard, and vulnerable minorities provide easy targets for exerting power, for being mean, for domination. It's an open question whether the aggression mainly serves a desire to dominate, or if the domination mainly serves a desire to hurt others. But either way, in the dog-eat-dog world of the social dominator, they're out to claw their way to the top.
Real quick, but I hope it's obvious that I'm only providing a brief summary of the psychological research into authoritarians here. If you're curious about the subject and want a more in-depth look, please check out Andrewism's video here. One fascinating thing about Final Fantasy VI is how it shows us what happens when a social dominator like Kefka succeeds. Regarding clawing his way to the top, he's gone ahead and done that. He has all the power in the world, becoming an almighty god. But, as we mentioned in the summary of his scenes, you can't help but notice that when we see him at the end of the game, he seems downright miserable. When you define your worth by acquiring power and dominating others, what happens when there's no more power to gain and no one you haven't victimized already? We see the hollowness of fascist ideology and its associated authoritarian strongmen laid bare. They're obviously morally bankrupt, but they're also absolutely bereft of values and meaning outside of their pursuit of power. Kefka has the power to do anything, to shape the world to his desires, but there he sits, despondent and bored. Chapter 5, Searching for Friends. We live during a time of modern wonders, but under the surface of this technological splendor, the world is more cruel and vicious than it's ever been. We're ruled by the worst among us, the greedy, the callous, and the bloodthirsty. And what's worse is that their insatiable hunger for power is driving this planet towards catastrophe. So is that it, then? Are we, the human race, doomed? What is to be done? What can be done? Have we failed? This is the grim prophecy of Final Fantasy VI. For decades, many of us living in this late capitalist hellscape have had this sense of unease. We've been haunted by a gnawing premonition that something isn't right, or, at the very least, that the current situation is not sustainable. What's remarkable is that the team at Squaresoft tapped into this unconscious dread all the way back in 1994. But the story doesn't end here. The world as we know it is destroyed, but there is still more game to play. At the start of the World of Ruin, the protagonists are scattered to the four winds, left to contemplate their defeat as individuals. This pertains to their grander, overarching failure to stop Kefka and to prevent the apocalypse as a collective, but we also see much more personal stories of loss and failure in several of the characters' side quests. We lead off with Celis, who, depending on how the player does at this fishing minigame, may fail to keep Cid alive. In such a case, this will lead to her attempting to off herself, an attempt that, thankfully, fails. From there, Setzer must upset the tomb of his partner Daryl to unearth her airship, the Falcon. Through dream sequences, we learn of Shadow's sordid past, his guilt and trauma around the death of his accomplice Barum, and hints that he is Realm's estranged father. Locke searches for the Phoenix, now Magicite, in order to bring Rachel back to life, a woman he felt he failed to protect in the past. But no character exemplifies these themes of loss and failure more than Sion. We first find him on Mount Zozo, where he's taken to writing letters and crafting silk flowers to send to Lola and Miranda. Lola, if you recall, was the lover of the injured Imperial deserter in Moblis, who has since unfortunately passed away. Sion, understanding how heartbroken Lola would be if she learned the truth, maintains the illusion that her lover is still alive by pretending to be him. Ultimately, Sion knows that he must divulge the truth eventually, writing this stirring letter.
Dear Lola, I'm writing to beg for your forgiveness. I'm guilty of perpetuating a terrible lie. I have only now recognized the error of my ways. I hope I can correct a great wrong. Your boyfriend, who you thought was in Moblis, passed away some time ago. I've been writing in his stead. We humans tend to allow the past to destroy our lives. I implore you not to let this happen. It is time to look forward, to rediscover love, and embrace the beauty of life. You have so much of life left to live. Sion.
This is where we re-recruit Sion, but something unusual is that there's another World of Ruin quest involving him. Most characters' quests are the ones in which you recruit them back into the party. After spending a night in Doma Castle, Sion doesn't wake up. He is possessed by spirits, first the three Dream Stooges, but then by an entity known as Rexxol. Rexxol, we're told, is this amalgam of the spirits of people killed in quote-unquote meaningless wars. Sion is a prime target for Rexxol as he still feels immense guilt and anger about the poisoning of Doma, where he lost his wife and child. Sion, having been a retainer for the King of Doma, also feels responsible for failing to protect his liege and his country. Freeing Sion of Rexxol's influence allows him to forgive himself and heal, and to forge forward without inhibition. This is not just a nice little story and character flourish, it's borne out in the mechanics as well. As a result of completing this quest, Sion attains the maximum level of his sword tech ability. At the same time, the party gains the Alexander Magicite. I want you to keep this in mind for a moment, but real quick, I want to ask you a question. Who is the main character of Final Fantasy VI? If you said Terra or Celis... Sorry, you're wrong. I award you no points. The truth is that there is no main character of Final Fantasy VI. Or a better way to put it is that everyone is the main character of Final Fantasy VI. Now, I can cite the word of God here. This is indeed the opinion of the game's producer, the legendary Hironobu Sakaguchi himself, but I don't need to. Yes, we start the game as Terra, and then we start the World of Ruin as Celis.
But this isn't an indication that either of these women is somehow more important than the rest of the cast, merely the fact that our story has to start with someone. Our perspective as the player can and does shift away from both of them, either at various points in the script or by our own choices. Final Fantasy VI is indisputably an ensemble piece. You technically can beat the game as just three characters, Celis, Edgar, and Setzer, but that's really difficult to pull off, especially without glitches, and the game presents a much easier path. This brings me back to what I brought up about Sion's Quest. With each one of these side quests, it's the party coming to the aid of an individual, helping them solve a problem or address an unresolved personal issue. Through this, the individual obviously becomes stronger, but the collective does as well, and not just by virtue of adding another member to the team. We feel this through gameplay. Completing a side quest in the World of Ruin not only bolsters the character we're re-recruiting with new gear and abilities, but in addition we find other weapons, armor, relics, and magicite that make the entire party more powerful. To be our best selves, we need our community to come through for us. And in order for that community to exist, we need to come through for it. These two things, community and individuality, have never been at odds with one another. Rather, one cannot exist without the other. The best way to help ourselves is to help each other. This is more than just saying or showing something beautiful. This is an activity. We're driving these scenes through our choices as the player, and it's through action that we feel this sentiment much more keenly. And it's here that we see that Final Fantasy VI isn't wielding all this darkness and dread for cheap shock value or out of some misguided sense of importance. It's not just presenting some truly heavy problems to cathartically vent frustration or grievance. It has an answer to them. And one thing is for certain. No matter how bleak things become, the answer is not to wallow in despair. Doomerism is the sentiment that things have spiraled so far out of control that all there's left for us to do is to resign ourselves to this fate. It is an understandable feeling, let's face it. From the looks of how things are going here in the real world, we humans have failed spectacularly. Climate catastrophe is upon us, and in our societies and governments around the world, the illusion of civility is quickly giving way to unfettered brutality. And while the blame for this sorry state of affairs falls entirely upon the ruling class, corporations, the capitalists who run and own them, and the politicians who enable them, our ongoing collective failure is that we allow this tiny group of individuals to continue ruling over us. And on this front, doomerism is useless. Actually, it's worse than useless. Through inaction, it furthers the harm being done to us and the world. Those in power, who are destroying the planet to make themselves even more powerful, are counting on us to give up and let them have their way. Doomerism is a dereliction of responsibility at the worst possible moment. It is true that we as individuals have next to no ability to solve the global scale problems we're facing. But as Final Fantasy VI shows us, there is a solution to this. Solidarity. Only by joining together and helping one another can we piece back together what was torn apart. And more than that, we can create a new and better world. Chapter 6. Balance is restored. We've come to the end. Our heroes have survived the apocalypse, helped one another resolve their personal struggles, and have banded together to defeat an authoritarian god of magic. And in doing so, they haven't just dethroned him and installed a new, more just ruler in his place, but they have completely eliminated magic from the world entirely. We have a few scenes of the party escaping Kefka's tower as it crumbles, showcasing what each character brings to the ensemble and the special relationships between them. The credits roll, and then the Falcon tours the skies. We see a ruined world now showing signs of recovery and rebirth. Dwayne and Cotteran's child is born in Mobliz, the Thamassans rebuild their town, and a seedling sprouts in Kolingan. Our last image is the Falcon soaring high in the heavens as the triumphant notes of "Balance is Restored" send us off. This enthusiastically joyous ending is what all the dread and desolation we endured was all about. Despite how dark it can get sometimes, Final Fantasy VI is ultimately an uplifting and optimistic story. But it's rather curious that the game concludes before examining the implications of this finale, because this situation is unusual. Most heroic narratives like this are incited when the villain upsets the order of the world, and then it's up to our brave protagonists to set things right by restoring the status quo. Sure, maybe the protagonists change significantly through the arc of the narrative, but at the end of the story, the world is usually not all that different than it was at the beginning. Kefka upset the order of the world for sure, but the heroes of Final Fantasy VI haven't turned back the clock. The world we see here is not the world of balance. Instead, it's a world that, as far as we know, has never existed before. We don't know if there was a time before the Warring Triad and the existence of magic, but we know that they no longer exist in this world. They're not buried or hidden or frozen in stone. They're gone. Forever. The implications of this are massive. As the game establishes, control of magical power has been the impetus for many conflicts, some of which have been outright apocalyptic, like the one we just experienced. Magical ability was also a hereditary trait passed down by espers and magi alike to their children. And as we've also noted here, despite having potential to do positive and constructive things, the game has overwhelmingly depicted magic as a weapon and a means for domination. While we're not shown what this new balance of power is like, I think it's reasonable to say that the elimination of magic is an unequivocal good for the entire world. The tone of this ending certainly paints it as such. So what does this mean with regard to the various interpretations and readings that I've put forward here? What is Final Fantasy VI saying about the state of our world? As this video has outlined, the magic of Final Fantasy VI resembles the social and political hierarchies of our world. These hierarchies have been around since before the start of recorded history, and despite, or perhaps due to, our supposed modern civility, these hierarchies have only gotten more coercive and more effective in their brutality. This imbalance of power is bad enough on its own, but even worse is that it attracts and rewards the most cruel, the most callous, and the most ruthless among us. Authoritarian social dominators like Kefka thrive in these environments, and great power is never enough for them. They are constantly striving for more, even if that means global-scale destruction. The delicate equilibrium of magic or the ecosystem mean little to them. The evidence bears this out. So what is to be done, then? The increasing disparities in power and wealth, the spread of armed conflict and exterminationist violence, the intensifying climate calamity, these are all problems that we cannot solve by ourselves as individuals. The first step for us is to stand together in solidarity, to organize our efforts, and to muster collective action. Those who wield power over us can only do so if we let them. If we refuse to work for them, if we refuse to follow their orders, if we refuse to fear them, their game is over. This won't be as easy as 12 heroes storming a tower and taking down the god of magic, now that's for sure. But like them, we're all but certain facing the ruin of our own planet, unfortunately. It won't be the end of the world, mind you, but things are going to get significantly worse. The only way we can fail, however, is if we give up. Don't give in to despair. Look for ways to help those around you, build community, organize. While social and political hierarchies have been with us for as long as we can remember, that does not mean they are a fundamental truth of human civilization. Together, we can make true freedom and equality for all a reality. A bright new world is possible. I've been wanting to make a comprehensive video on all my thoughts about Final Fantasy VI since I started this channel over 2 years ago. This means a lot to me, so thank you so much if you've watched this entire video. I have a big announcement to make here. In January, I decided to leave my corporate game dev job at Night School Studio and Netflix. So I am extremely excited to announce that I am going independent, which also means that I can dedicate much more of my time to this channel. As I promised in my 2023 wrap-up video, I will be delivering another big video essay on zombies and video games. That's due out right before Halloween. But I will also be looking to do some smaller videos in the meantime, including a new video next week. So please be sure to subscribe to the channel and click the bell so you get notified when that goes up. But one downside of going indie is that I no longer have a reliable source of income. That is why I've decided to officially launch my Patreon. If you like what I do here and you've got a dollar or two to spare each month, your support can help me keep going and make these videos even better. Patrons will get ad-free, uncensored videos early, as well as some other fun perks. Check it out at patreon.com/infernalramblings. If you don't have the funds to spare, you can always give the video a thumbs up and share these videos on your social media feed. And hey, if you hated the video, that's what the thumbs down button is there for. And as always, I'm interested to hear your thoughts down in the comments. Thanks for watching. Peace, love, and solidarity.